Hello, I'm Peter Boyle from the Particle Physics Research Group in the School of Physics and Astronomy at the University of Edinburgh. In my research, I use computers to simulate a strong force. What is mass? Isaac Newton told us it is how hard we have to push something to change its speed. At the quantum level, particles are described by ripples in fields. We have plane waves. We can think of theta as a kind of angle, the phase angle. The amount of energy in each wavelength is quantized. De Broglie told us that the momentum is related to how tight these ripples are. Einstein told us energy is related to how fast the wave oscillates in time. For a given particle, the energy depends on the momentum in a specific way. For massless particles, the square of the energy is proportional to the square of the momentum. But for massive particles, there is rest energy, or rest mass, E equals mc squared. The speed is given by the slope of E with p. For massless particles, this is 1. Massive particles have the familiar p equals mv in the non-relativistic limit. For massive particles, this separation is m squared c to the fourth. This beautiful simplicity gets broken because space still contains stuff like water, glass, metals, or you and I. When massless particles, like light, travel through a medium, they slow down. We see this as bending when we dip a paintbrush in water. Light couples to the charges in normal matter. Neutrinos only couple to matter very weakly. They usually pass straight through the Earth unaffected. We know glass splits light into separate wavelengths. The speed in glass depends on the momentum, and light no longer follows its massless energy momentum relation. A big question is, does a medium give light mass? Well, glass and water are complicated because the charges are bound in molecules. Conductors, however, are simpler because the charges are free to move. We've all seen that light bounces off silvered glass, mirrors. Simpler still are superconductors, where there is no resistance at all below a critical temperature. The origins of the Higgs mechanism lie in the understanding of superconductivity stemming from Ginzburg and Landau in 1950. Electrons pair, spin up and spin down, and below a critical temperature, the density of the Cooper pairs, phi, becomes non-zero. We explain in more detail later in this section. For now, when the material superconducts, the magnetic field becomes massive inside the superconductor. The superconductor spits out the magnetic field lines and will levitate above a magnet in what is known as the Meissner effect. Now, we're going to look at the Higgs mechanism. Let's try to understand some of the pieces. Minus a quarter f mu, f mu. That's shorthand for electromagnetism and Maxwell's equations. This is equal to E squared minus V squared, which is the energy density of the electric and magnetic fields. You probably know E from the parallel plate capacitor, where if we have a potential difference between these plates, we have an electric field in the middle. Where the separation is D. Note that V V0 is arbitrary. That is, we can add a constant to electrostatic potential without changing any physics. D mu phi squared. Here, phi is a scalar complex field. That means it has two components. Phi equals phi 1, phi 2. Professor Higgs has drawn the two components here as Cartesian coordinates. This term, d mu phi, couples the scalar field to the electromagnetism. We'll draw phi 1 and phi 2 as Cartesian coordinates on a plane. If we take a value of the field, we can take this angle theta as a phase angle for the field. Now we have our two Cartesian coordinates, and we can draw the energy density associated with the potential term V phi as a function of these two coordinates. And we see we have a Mexican hat-shaped potential. The Cooper-Pair field of superconductivity develops just such a potential when the Meissner effect occurs. If we ignore electromagnetism and the potential term for now, a massless Higgs field satisfies a wave equation. This is really easy to solve. You just need help from a flexible friend. Recall, phi has two components. Phi 1 and phi 2. We'll represent all of space as the perpendicular direction, and time will be time. With the slinky, we can represent phi 1 and phi 2 by the position of the slinky. Space is the vertical direction, and time is time. We see that phi 1 can oscillate, phi 2 can oscillate. The slinky is solving the wave equation. Of course, both directions can oscillate at the same time, either clockwise, which we identify with particle modes, or anticlockwise, which we identify with antiparticles. The amplitudes of these modes are quantized. We can write down the particle solutions. Phi 1 equals A cos px minus et, and phi 2 equals A sine px minus et. And we can think of these as being associated with a phase angle theta of x and t, which is equal to this term, theta px minus et. So what about mass? Well, for that, we have to look and introduce a potential term. That's quite hard with the slinky, so we'll do a thought experiment. We'll consider the slinky as a set of masses living on disks. The position of each mass represents phi 1 and phi 2. These little masses will be connected by massless springs. And there'll be a tower of these disks going all the way to plus and minus infinity in space. If the masses are small and the distance is small, these will still satisfy the same wave equation. Note also, for later reference, that even if we shift phi by a constant, it'll still satisfy the wave equation and still have the same type of oscillations. Now, however, we can introduce a potential by sticking extra springs to each mass. On each disk. This will have the shape of a quadratic potential, and a bit like a skateboarder in a roller park, phi will develop its own oscillations, as well as because of the wave equation, from this potential. We'll call these springs wave springs. And the springs living on each disk, potential springs. And we can see, if we consider our slinky and pretend that it's also being acted upon by these potential springs, that we acquire a restoring force for our circular waves, both from the wave springs and from the potential springs. In particular, if you consider an infinite wavelength, constant z momentum mode, and displace it, it will still oscillate solely because of these potential springs. That means the particle has energy when it's at rest, rest mass. Another point to note is that by introducing this mass, we have lost the freedom to shift the field to any value and still have a wave solution. The field prefers to be at value zero. We've seen that a zero or constant potential corresponds to massless particles, and that a quadratic or bowl-shaped potential corresponds to massive particles. The question now is, does the Mexican hat potential correspond to massive or massless particles? And the answer, as we'll see, is both. So we'll continue our thought experiment, imagining that this potential applies to our slinky. First of all, the field phi must choose a value for the vacuum, for where we start. It has to lie somewhere on the minimum of this energy. There are many values around this minimum line, and the field must choose one of these spontaneously. We'll call its value V for vacuum expectation value. Because the field spontaneously chooses this, the process is called spontaneous symmetry breaking. If we align the slinky with this vacuum expectation value, we can analyze how its fluctuations around this behave. Fluctuations in the radial direction receive a restoring force from this potential. Fluctuations along the minimum do not. If we again think of the infinite wavelength zero momentum mode, we will see that displacements in the radial direction continue to oscillate, receiving a restoring force from this potential. These are massive modes. The mass is determined by the curvature of this potential at the minimum. Constant modes, infinite wavelength, zero momentum, which are displaced around the minimum, do not receive any restoring force from the potential, and therefore they remain massless and do not oscillate. In fact, we see that the number of massless modes is the dimension of this minimum. In our case, it's simple. The dimension is 1. We have a single line, admittedly bent, but the circle is a single line. In more complicated situations, the dimension can be bigger. This is Goldstone's theorem. The massless modes are Goldstone bosons. Goldstone's theorem was thought to rule out spontaneous symmetry breaking in a relativistic field theory. This is because the massless modes would have taken no energy to create and should have already been seen. The Higgs mechanism provides an escape to Goldstone's theorem.